been described as really the excessive desire to get what you want, or really to have that sense of material gain and wealth in your life. It's to acquire or to possess anything more than you actually might have, what you might earn. It has no boundaries and crosses all ethnicities, all social status, and even traditions. Its warning signs include really spending more than you earn in the first place. It's a favorite to many, it's a foe to all. Your favorite sin and mine, greed. Greed. It's been said that greed is one of those weaknesses of our age that has that inherent inability to distinguish our needs from our wants, or in this case, the element of greed. The fallacy is that there's this need of fulfillment in our lives and wholeness that we need and rest really in the assurance of our wants. By practice, the hooks of greed has taken the best of those who are clergy, politicians, actors, interior decorators, and we could probably just even add our names to the list as well. They say greed is something that begins even in birth and in childhood, that time when we rely so much on that connection between our mother and that space that connects us at the navel. Greed is something, too, that reminds us that the security in which we had in the womb thrust us into a world of wants. I want a bottle. I want a clean diaper. Not today. You know, at some point we'll realize the value in that roll of toilet paper that was shown today as well. But we also, as a child too, will want that element of an embrace, that sense of love in our lives. We want a toy. These are all innocent. These are very natural for a child growing up. But somehow along the line, someone adds a little bit of fuel to the fire and tells the kid, I'm not sure who it is, but someone tells the kid that their parents has this tree growing in the backyard, and it's growing what? Money. You've got that tree too? Yeah, I'll be right over. You know, a few years ago, this whole notion of money growing on a tree, or this inerrant idea that greed is this kind of half-heartedly idea, showed up in the Rennick household when we traveled and went on vacation over to San Diego. We went to this little place called Seaport Village. Maybe you know where it's at there, you know, the Coronado Island is just across the bay. It's right there on the San Diego Harbor. It's a very nice place. You can smell the salt in the air. People are walking along there. Kids are giggling and laughing on the carousel that's there. Young love is in the air as folks on their first date are walking hand in hand. There's that artist over there that can draw a funny caricature of yourself. And then reality starts to set in as you start to realize that those things you start to buy, like the food and the trinkets, the souvenirs at Seaport Village, just seem to kind of get you where you least expect it. You see, I've come under the conclusion that really, among these quaint shops there, amongst the sailboat that drifts by, we get caught up in the serenity, and then the buying gets caught up in us. You know, they might as well call Seaport Village Suck Your Money Out of Your Wallet Village. Do you know what I mean? You know, as far as vacations go, the high markup of things there, from the hot dogs and ice cream to the t-shirts and other little trinkets, are just enough to make you go home and chop down that money tree and convince the kid that the water sprinkler hose is a lot more exciting than the beach at San Diego. Well, the Rennicks came across this t-shirt shop at Suck Your Money Out of Your Wallet Village called Crazy Shirts. Now, it wasn't because the sayings on the shirts were crazy, it's because you had to be crazy to buy the shirts in the first place. Who brought the laughing bag to church? At any rate, you can guess, I bought two shirts. And my oldest son, Philip, convinced me that he was really buying one of those shirts for me, bless his heart. The shirt had this saying right across the, and I think this is what motivated him in the first place. It said, "Amazing Dad." Got me right here. Actually, it's a little bit lower back in here. It said, "Amazing Dad." It was pretty amazing in its own right. It said, "He's made of magic money, knows all, sees all, gives all." And as if there wasn't any shortage of ink, they decided to print another slogan at the bottom of the shirt that read, "Money disappears right in front of his eyes." In front of my eyes, I never had a moment to touch the cash in the first place. Which brings us back to this notion of greed, our topic for today. Greed is something that accumulates over life. It's something that gets a hold of us and usually can consume our life. It can cloud our moral values and our understanding of what's important in the first place. You see, with wealth, you can get most anything that you want. You see, greed preaches that slogan, "He or she who dies with the most toys wins." I don't know who wins at that, but I do remember as a young child watching the movie Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. Remember that movie, the one with Gene Wilder, the cool guy, not the creepy one? And the story remains the same there, that there's this young boy named Charlie Bucket. He gets the golden ticket, and he gets to go to the Chocolate Factory. Well, if you know the story, there are four other kids that also get to go to the Chocolate Factory, too. And really, the whole story kind of revolves around these kids. Really more so about their personalities. And as we start to see their personalities evolve in the story there, we begin to realize and we say to ourselves, "Thanks God, those aren't like my kids. Because they're a bunch of spoiled brats, aren't they?" One in particular is this girl by the name of Veruca Salt. Veruca wants everything. I mean everything. And if you remember her character, she's always asking her daddy, "Daddy, I want this. Daddy, I want that." And they go into this one room, and lo and behold, what's there? Geese. "Dad, I want one of those geese." Because these geese do what? They lay golden eggs. "Daddy, I want one of these golden eggs. Daddy, I want one now." "Later, honey." "No, now." And to her demise, she runs around the room there, and there's this place where they measure the eggs to see if they're a good egg or bad egg. And she stands up there, and she has her last verse and word, and of course, of the song she sings, and the contraption down to the garbage chute marks her as a bad egg. Now, I tell you that piece about Veruca because really, the whole story itself also seems to revolve around these short people called Oompa Loompas. And they bring out a sense of understanding, and maybe this is what's behind the motive of the author of Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, that we all have conditions and personalities in our lives. And when it comes to this certain character, Veruca Salt, they are not at a loss to comment and to provide their little twist on Oompa Loompa Faith. I invite you to hear their words as they comment on Veruca Salt.
"Oompa Loompa Doompa Dee Doo, I've got another puzzle for you. Oompa Loompa Doompa Dee Dee, if you are wise, you'll listen to me. Who do you play when your kid is up? Rat, pan, bird, and spot like a Siamese. Cat, blaming the kids is a lion up. Shame to know exactly who's to blame. The mother and the father. Oompa, oompa, doompa dee da. If you're not spoiled, then you will go far. You will live in happiness too. Like the Oompa Loompa Loompa Dee Doo."
For the next couple weeks, I want to address the themes of greed and also generosity. And in doing that, I want to ask a couple questions. Today we ask the question, "What's in it for me?" Next week we'll ask the question, "What's in it for God?" You see, Oompa Loompa Faith offers us a little pithy perspective, maybe what's similar to Jesus when it came to his parables when he was addressing people. He wanted to hold up a mirror or a picture to the community and to the people that were gathered around to challenge them to hear something that they may not wanted to hear, to see something that they didn't want to see, but as Jesus would say, with eyes to see and ears to hear, let them hear. And so Jesus is gathered around a bunch of people today as we read in the narrative this morning from the Gospel of Luke. And someone brings up a tenuous subject when he says, "Hey Jesus, you know, there's my brother and I, and Dad recently died. Who should get the inheritance? Or, you know, who should get most of it?" And Jesus goes on and he says, "You know, why are you worrying about it? Really, we need to step back for just a moment and understand what was going on in Jesus' day. Culturally, in Jesus' day, the oldest son would have received twice as much of the inheritance as any of the other children in the family. So the one person received half, and he's looking at his brother who's, you know, he got to get what was behind door number one, and he's all excited about that. But Jesus is saying, why are you even knocking that in the first place? You should be happy with what you have and what's been given to you." And that's really the short end to that long story, that life is not to be measured on the terms of wealth or even possessions. Well, even the book of Luke itself lifts up those ideas of what it understands to mean to have things or what you do with stuff and how to be grateful for it. In the Gospel of Luke, we can read a phrase that says, "One may gain the whole world and lose one soul." Or, on the other hand, true blessing comes to those who hear the word of God and adhere to it. You know, it was believed that when a person had wealth and riches back in Jesus' day and even way back in the Old Testament, God really liked them. They were kind of like God's pet. They were very righteous. They were loving of God. And so God gave them a reward. And here Jesus is holding up one of these examples here, talking out of the Jewish tradition, saying, "You know what? Your father's dead. He left you rewards as it is because of his faithfulness. Stop bickering about it in the first place." But then he starts talking about the warnings of getting absorbed in the sense of wealth. And we could turn to the Bible and hear other things that talk about wealth and what you do with it in the first place. We read that good things, bad things, life and death itself come from the Lord. I don't agree with that, but at least that's the experience that was happening in the time of Jesus' day. And Jesus probably would have gone on to say, you know, the Lord's gift remains with the devout, and with favor that is brought upon them can last forever. And then one becomes rich through diligence and self-denial. It's kind of that whole American principle. You got to work hard to get ahead in life. And then he goes on further to say that the person might say they have rest. They've received a bunch of wealth in their life, so let's go on and eat and enjoy life. But then when he leaves, who knows what is left to others when they die. You see, for the community of faith that was gathered in Jesus' day, that evolved after this post-resurrection experience and event, the notion is, sure, the fields are there, the abundance is available, and God blesses those who, you know, kind of look after themselves and work hard and such. Those are the provisions that were provided to the community, but the person also had a job, too, to provide for the community as well. We're reminded of Joseph in the Old Testament there, who looks out for the time when a famine would come, and he gathers up the granary of his master, and he stores it in a house, and he provides for the people when a famine comes. This story that we read of the boy's dad, it's pretty commendable. You know, who can fault the person who saves up for a rainy day? Who can blame the person who sets up a little nest egg for life and what might happen and what can occur in the lives of those who may leave when they die? What about the parent that saves up for a child so that they can have a good college degree or even an experience of school? You know, bravo to the person who saves up every paycheck there a little bit to put into their 401k to provide for some comfortable years of retirement. You see, it's about the future, and sure, it makes for good stewardship sense to set money aside whenever possible. The way I see it, the farmer was a pretty successful business owner. He made the right investments, and over time, they yield highly. He's earned his money. You know, a barn full of grain saved is a barn full of grain earned. He did all the right things. But Jesus stands before the community, and now the kids who want what's maybe rightfully theirs looks at him and he says, you know, it's all about money. It's all about the possessions and the wealth of it. Sure, go, relax, eat, and drink, but forget about those who are around you. That's not who I am. You see, he says, what shall we do? Well, we know what the farmer will do. He wants to build a bigger place. He wants to invest in a better investment portfolio and plan, maybe a different bank that provides that opportunity for them to have even more. See, the punchline, what it really comes down to is it's maybe better to die a poor farmer than a rich fool, as Jesus looks at these two brothers here, reminds them of this little pithy Oompa Loompa story that says God comes and says, woe to you, because all you can think about was yourself. So what's the message for us today? Well, what do we do? It's a question of a meaning of life and a sense of how we gather that for ourselves, that sure, greed can take a hold of us in many different ways and look different as well. You see, but what happens when we begin to fill our barn with self rather than God? What happens is we begin to forget about who we can lean on, where the blessings come from, where the source of life comes from, and that is from God. You see, the fine print of this story might read something like this. Listen to that inner voice and ask, what do you hear? Is there a voice of want or is there a voice of need? Maybe there's yet another voice that speaks to the Veruca salt in us that says, I need you just to listen to the voice and what I need. What do you need? Remember last week we talked about some of those needs, and one of them is just to come to church and know that at least we're valued, like we're someone special. You know, the movie Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory ends with these words if we were to flip to the last page. And we read that if you want to view paradise, simply look around and view it. Anything you want to do, do it. Want to make the world, there's nothing to it. There's no life I know to compare with pure imagination. Live there, you'll be free if you truly wish to be. See, Oompa Loompa Faith is about using our imaginations for God to imagine the possible with the impossible. To imagine that a barn full of grain is a house of hope for others who have no food. To imagine a tree of money that's not something we hoard in our backyard, but something we stretch out to help others be lifted up and alive. We are to imagine a world free of division, of politics. To imagine a community that's unified in the goodness of Christ. You see, we're made to worship God. Not the things God made, those are just temporary, but given to us as a way to honor God. You see, we are the ones who are the house that God builds. We're the house that stores the grain. We're not to be held by greed, but we are to be open with generosity. We're the treasures that shall never be taken away, but we're to burst forth and to feed and to serve our neighbors and our communities. That's the Oompa Loompa faith. To not ask the question, what's in it for me, but eventually to get to the element of God's abundancy in our lives, in which we ask, what's in it for God? And next week we'll talk about what's in it for God. This week we want to just say, what have I done with what I think has been about me, but really what God has given to us and allows us to do with this the impossible, but to dream. Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen. Amen.